Happy Easter!
We're so glad you came and joined us here at Forest Hills United Methodist Church online. We're all gathered in our homes across the world, just like the New Testament church was gathered in their homes all those years ago to celebrate this wonderful Sunday when our Lord rose from the dead. We're so grateful for that, and we're glad to welcome you to worship with us this morning.
In the midst of all of this COVID-19 mess, we are glad that you're with us, and we hope that you experience the joy of the resurrected Lord in your heart, in your home, and in your lives. Amen.
On this glorious Easter Sunday, we proclaim as the people of God, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Glory and honor, dominion and power be to God forever and ever. Christ is risen. Alleluia, alleluia. Amen. As we gather in this place, on Easter Sunday, we gather with full hearts and we pray together. Risen Lord, you are among us bringing new life. You are in our homes, in our churches, in our community, in our world, and in our hearts. We praise you and give you all the glory, laud, and honor. On this day of your resurrection, be with us, we pray. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you this morning to join us here at Forest Hills United Methodist Church in our favorite welcome chorus, Surely the Presence of the Lord is in this place. And following the chorus, to take a moment to greet those in your home, maybe send a text to a friend, or a Happy Easter to someone you love. Let us join together in song. Once again, to our Forest Hills family, good morning and happy Easter. What a glorious day it is for us to be worshiping together. Although we are not here in this sanctuary, we are together in heart and mind and soul as we worship the risen Lord. And for this and for you, we are thankful. As we think about the week to come, we just think about the joy of Easter, and we pray that you will hold that close to your heart and in your family and in your home. Please continue to check out those daily spiritual check-ins. They'll be arriving to you each day. We want to stay connected, and if there's anything we can do to be helpful to you and your family, ways that we can pray for you or serve you, please let us know, and we will be glad to do our best to reach out in love and care. As we gather this day on Easter, most of all, our hearts are filled with joy as we celebrate the risen Lord, Jesus Christ.
Good morning. Our opening hymn this morning is Christ the Lord is Risen Today, hymn 302. We will sing stanzas 1, 3, and 4. Would you celebrate with us at home this morning?
Today, hallelujah.
On this day of all days, we affirm our faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ with the words of the Apostles' Creed. Will you join me? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. It is in the light and glory of this day that we lift our prayers together. We honor the prayers that you hold in your heart, prayers of joy and prayers of concern, and we bind them with our prayers as we pray as one body to our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us join in prayer this holy day. Gracious God, living Lord, Spirit that flows among us, on this Easter Sunday, what can we do but shout Alleluia? He is risen. He is risen indeed. What can we do but bow before our Lord Jesus Christ, who has made a way for us to live fully now and always through his death and resurrection. The light that you bring, O Lord, is a light that we cannot imagine, and no darkness can overcome it. So on this day, we give you praise and honor and glory, offering all of ourselves to you in worship. Look inside of us, and as you do, I know that you see all of us. Cleanse us, make us whole, so that on this Easter day, we would hold nothing back as we proclaim your resurrection and your glory. Make us whole so that we might love you more and better, love others more and better, and love your world in a way that expresses care and concern for all the needs that rise up around us. We ask, O God, for deep healing for the world, for those who are suffering with COVID-19, we ask for healing. For those who serve on the front lines, doctors, nurses, medical personnel, those who are in the stores taking care of our needs, every person in essential services, we ask for your protection. For those making decisions, leaders in businesses and around the world, we ask for wisdom. And for your church, we ask for compassionate hearts that will care for one another in unprecedented times. And through all of this, may your name be praised. We turn to you, O God, with gratitude overflowing as we pray the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our offertory hymn this morning is hymn 303, The Day of Resurrection. We invite you to sing with us at home.
Well, happy Easter Sunday morning to you. I am delighted that you have tuned in online. There are five of us worshiping here in this space physically. I will say that last year we had something like 850 or 950 people worshiping, but we have probably that amount online, and we are delighted that you chose to worship and to spend Easter Sunday morning with us. I also just want to extend to you the invitation to continue to support your local church. If that's Forest Hills, you can do so by giving online, or you can write a check and drop it in the mail. We have folks that check the mailbox each day, and we will deposit those checks and continue the operation of our ministries here. And if Forest Hills is not your home church, but you do have a home church, I'd invite you to write a check to them to continue their ministries faithfully, so that collectively we can continue to spread the good news of our resurrected Lord to this world who needs good news so desperately. Thank you.
Thank you.
I hope it comes through as well in the video feed as it does live in this place this morning, but the music has been fantastic. What a good celebration of Easter Sunday musically. I have a non-traditional passage that I'm going to begin with for our Easter Sunday sermon. I'm reading from Luke chapter 23. I'll read from verse 50 through the end of the chapter. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he himself was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth, and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been laid. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes. But they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. There's a fact that some of you may know about me, but I really like Jackie Chan. And in fact, I own somewhere in the neighborhood of 40 Jackie Chan movies. Now, you might wonder why anyone would buy 40 Jackie Chan movies. The reason is very simple. I could rent them for $4 a piece, watch them once, and then return the movie, or I could buy them for $5 a piece and watch them as often as I want through the rest of my life. So economically, it just made sense for me to buy these movies. But sometimes borrowing is a better financial proposition than buying. We were driving home to Georgia from Toronto, Canada, one time, and the Toyota Tercel that I was driving blew up. Literally, the engine blew up right on the border with Detroit. So I figured there's no way I'm going to end up repairing this car. It had high miles on it. Parts and labor are really expensive in Canada. So we ended up going across the border to the Detroit airport, rented a car, and drove home from there. And I sold the car for scrap. When we got home, I wanted the cheapest vehicle that I could buy that was reliable. So I went on the Mazda dealership, and I bought a little Mazda pickup truck with one option. Because it was Georgia, I optioned air conditioning. Well, I drove that truck for a couple years. The only thing I did to it is change out the speakers. I like decent sound. And I put a lockbox in the back of the trunk. Well, I had it parked at Ebenezer United Methodist Church parking lot. And this guy from the base would cut through the parking lot every single day. And he fell in love with that cheap pickup truck. Apparently, Mazda stopped making it in that color, and I think they didn't make the manual transmission anymore. But whatever it was, he fell in love with my little Mazda pickup truck. And one day, he came into the office, and he made an offer that I couldn't refuse. He ended up buying my 2-year-old used pickup truck for just about what I paid brand new for it. I thought I could get rid of the pickup truck anyway. The only thing I ever threw in the bed were our bicycles when we would go to the trails and ride our mountain bikes. So I got rid of the pickup truck, and within 2 days, I had a Mazda Miata convertible. Mazda Miata convertible. I'm not a pickup truck guy, but I am a convertible guy. Here's the reality. I know easily 25 people who own pickup trucks. So on the rare occasion that I need to move something or haul something away, I can call one of them and they are always ready, always available. So I borrow the pickup truck. In fact, I found that sometimes it just makes sense to borrow. We're in home renovations right now. You know, I bought a fixer-upper 5 years ago, and I've renovated 3 bathrooms and 4 bedrooms, a school room, a den, a kitchen, and I've also renovated a living room. So we're almost done on the inside, just a few minor projects, and I'm now tackling the outside. Because it's a 2-story house with a really high chimney, I needed a ladder. I have two A-frame ladders, but I don't own an extension ladder. Well, Lyle, our trusty chair, happens to own a 32-foot-long extension ladder. Now, those bad boys cost somewhere in the neighborhood of $350 or $400. And the problem is, I only need it for a few weeks. And when I'm done with it, where do you store a 32-foot-long extension ladder? It's only about 18 feet when it's collapsed, but where do you store such a thing? So Lyle was gracious enough to allow me to use his ladder while I do this job. Borrowing made better sense, the investment of cost and then the storage afterward. I was struck as I was reading the stories this week of Jesus' crucifixion, his judgment, his burial, and of course, his resurrection. And last week, what we realized is that Jesus was a borrower. 2,000 years ago, Jesus borrowed a donkey. You think about that. He didn't have to register it with the equivalent of the Jerusalem DMV. He didn't go to some donkey lot and pick out which color donkey he wanted and make sure it had that new donkey smell. I don't know if there is a new donkey smell, but I don't think it would be very good anyways. Jesus borrowed the donkey because he only needed it for one ride. It was a whole lot simpler to borrow than to buy. But what's also striking about this Holy Week is on Friday, on Good Friday, Jesus borrowed a tomb. He didn't put much thought into where his body would be buried because he knew that he would be raised again on the third day. This wasn't his permanent dwelling. It wasn't his forever home. He didn't go and look around at various locations at tombs to see which one had the better view. I'm always amazed by folks who go to cemeteries and find the plot that they want with the best view. When I'm dead, I'm not going to be looking at anything anyway. Put me anywhere you want. Jesus, I think, had a similar attitude. He didn't go and measure the inside of that carved out tomb and get it just right so it could be customized with wall-to-wall carpet or some plank flooring. Jesus put no thought at all into the tomb that he was borrowing because he knew that he wasn't going to be there long term. In fact, Jesus put so little thought into the tomb that he didn't even make these preparations himself. The passage that we just read let us know that Joseph of Arimathea had a tomb that had never been used, that was cut from the rock, cut out of the side of the hill, and without even thinking about it, gave it to Jesus, not realizing that Jesus only needed to borrow it. He didn't need it as a permanent gift. Borrowing sometimes just makes sense. In the history of the world, I can guarantee you there were thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people who borrowed donkeys. Donkeys, after all, were the New Testament and Old Testament version of a pickup truck. If you go to a yard sale and get some really good stuff, borrow Ishmael's donkey to haul it all home. If you're moving and you need extra storage, get a wagon, borrow a donkey, and away you go. Whatever might be happening, donkeys could be borrowed if you wanted. And I'm sure thousands upon thousands of donkeys have been borrowed in the course of human history. But how many tombs have been borrowed? I would contend that only one. And that tomb was borrowed by the conqueror of death. Yes, Jesus died. He died for the sins of humanity. He died so that through our faith in him, we could be set in a proper relationship with God and have our sins forgiven. But death did not have the final victory over Jesus. He died, but he rose again. Sometimes, especially a season like we're in right now, I think we need to ask and answer this question. What story are we in? Who is writing the narrative? You see, we are in the Easter story. We are Easter people. Jesus died. We understand that that happened on Good Friday. Good for us, not for him. But we are an Easter people because on this day, Jesus stepped out alive from the grip
of death. He stepped out of that tomb that he had just borrowed for a weekend because he conquered death. And he conquered the grave and he conquered hell. We are in a story with the ultimate of happy endings. We are in the story where we follow a Lord who conquered the grave and leads us into life everlasting. Luke 24, we're going to finish the story off that we just began, beginning at verse 1. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen." And then we read in John chapter 20, verse 19 and 20. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. COVID-19 might make us all feel like we're in a cold tomb. We are socially distancing. We're cut off from the living. We're cut off from the rest of the world. We're cut off from that intimate physical connection that we enjoy on Sunday mornings. COVID-19 might make us feel like we're in a tomb filled with our anxiety about our health, our family, our finances. COVID-19 might bring fear to our hearts and lives, fear about the future, fear about the unknown. But folks, like the disciples who were hidden in fear behind the locked doors, we can even now imagine Jesus stepping gloriously into our midst, not dead, but alive. He brings life wherever he is. He brings joy and happiness wherever he is. Jesus is bigger than our problems. Jesus is bigger, more powerful than the coronavirus. And Jesus is with us even now. Regardless of where you may be, regardless of where you may be, what you may be going through, Jesus is with you and Jesus can impart strength. Here is the paradox of the Christian faith. Jesus died so that we could live. Here's the paradox of the Christian faith. Jesus invites us to give him our sin, and he gives us his righteousness. We give him our filth. He gives us his perfection. Jesus invites us through faith in him to give our death to him, and he transfers to us eternal life. We will all experience what Jesus experienced on Good Friday, not in the same way that it unfolds, but we are mortal beings. And we will all pass from this life to the next at some point. But here, folks, here is the story of Easter, that when we pass from this life, the death that we experience is only temporary. Sort of like borrowing a tomb, because we know that there is a resurrection in the end and that we will be with Christ forever. That is the faith that we have. That is the certainty of our hope in Jesus Christ. We, this morning, wherever you may be watching around this world of ours, we, because of our faith in Jesus, we are Easter people. And we know who wrote the narrative. We know what story we are in. We are in a story of love and peace and hope and joy. May the Jesus, the resurrected Jesus of this story, fill your home and your heart and your life on this beautiful day. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you that you only needed to borrow a tomb. Thank you that you didn't need to be there forever. It was not your permanent residence, your forever home. But when you stepped from death to life, you gave us victory over the grave. And we know now that to die, to be absent from this body, is to be present with you. That is the joy, that is the certainty of our hope as Easter people. Lord, if there is anyone watching this broadcast that does not have that hope this Easter Sunday morning, Lord, do your work in their heart. Give to them the gift of salvation, the assurance of their salvation, and let them experience the joy of Christ this Easter season. And Lord, for those who have this hope, but they've forgotten about it, they may have even forgotten whose story we are in, and who it is that is writing our narrative, may we be reaffirmed this morning that we are in your story, that we are Easter people, that we serve the God who conquered the grave, who only need to borrow a tomb. Lord, let us live into that story with the joy, the peace, and the hope, and the love that is ours because of Christ Jesus, our resurrected Lord. Amen.
I serve a risen Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever foes may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always here. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart.
I'm going to use this as our benediction. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blasts. Can you say COVID-19 and social distancing? The day of his appearing will come at last. Church, he lives. He lives in this world. He lives in your family. He lives in your home. He lives in your heart. Go with the presence of Christ in you. Go in love, in joy, in peace, and in hope and live the difference that Christ's resurrection makes. Amen.